Now, I'd say the fundamentals to fabrication and building things like this here really break down to 5 steps. I have to say, having a good plan is definitely step number 1. Not only is that going to affect the other things that we're going to do, like the material cut links, the bill of materials, the weld out, the finish that we're going to put on, everything. Now, I'd say the plan almost always starts off with some sort of a vision or an idea, or someone hands it to you. In this case, my dad's cashing in one of those I paid for your welding school coupons, and he sent me this picture, and this is what he wanted for Christmas. The first thing I'm gonna do with any fabrication project is go right to the notebook, a pen, and a straight edge, because I'm gonna start sketching things out. This is gonna give you the general gist of the build, the design of it, the pieces and parts and where they go. It really gives you a good idea of what you're going for. And then trying to put together some sort of cut list or bill of materials so that you can call the metal supply and get what you need. I use a laptop and it helps me do all the math for me when I put it into like Fusion 360. If you don't have something like that, you should get one of these tradesman calculators. They are invaluable because you could put in feet and inches and fractions and it'll convert it for you into millimeters, it'll convert it into feet and inches and yards, and it keeps everything within the welder tolerances. It doesn't put those crazy fractions that are like a 64th. You don't need that kind of stuff. In this case, I always order a little bit extra of what I think I need and round stuff up, whatever you want to call it, because there's always a time where you make a wrong cut or you cut something at the wrong angle. I don't know how good you are, but I'm not that good, and it almost always happens. Now, if you're working for a shop, hopefully they've given you the plan and you don't have to worry about all those things. They've already have those parts cut, but you need to make sure you got the job number and the job number matches the part number that you're working with, along with the heat number, because everything goes together when it comes to quality control and working for someone else. The very first job that I ever got, that was the first thing I had to do, was look at a huge blueprint and look at a box of parts and put a pressure vessel together, which was very daunting. If you don't know, you really should be focusing on getting those weld drawings and blueprint symbols. If y'all want to learn more about that stuff, I'd be happy to share what I've learned. Having a good plan like this is going to give you a whole lot more foresight into the build, especially for your cut links and what you're trying to achieve as far as miters and things along that nature. You got to put a little thought into it, but it's going to beat having to be like, oh, does this fit? How? What is this length? Go cut it. What is this length? Go cut it. We're going to cut everything in one setting because we have a good plan. Now that we've got the plan laid out in front of us, that's pretty much what I'm going to keep in front of me when I'm cutting any type of material. I'm usually going to have a square in front of me so that I can make my marks with either a soapstone or a scribe, or my two favorite. Depending on the material I'm working with, I may use a marker. And of course, the tape measure that we should always have on us at any time as a fabricator. Hey, who is that? Get over here. Listen, right now. If you don't go learn how to read a freaking tape measure, I swear to God, it's all it takes. You can't be a fabricator without knowing how to read a freaking tape measure. Just grab some stuff, just start measuring it and writing it down. Maybe throw in some addition and some fraction. It's good for you. Learn to read a tape measure, for Pete's sakes. Now I'm just gonna grab some metal off the rack. I got this all from my local metal supply. I really do like to cut up all of my material for the fabrication project beforehand. Just keeps everything organized and neat, where you only have a few tools out at a time, and then you can kind of clean up the mess when you're done. The problem with this, if you make a few wrong cuts, it's going to take a minute before you figure out that you did something wrong. That's why it's important to have a good plan and doing the fabrication mantra. Measure twice, cut once. If you go about taking your tape measure, pulling a measurement, making your mark, taking a measurement, making sure that mark's in the right spot, and then sliding that material into the saw. Now all we have to worry about is on what side of the line we need to cut on. It might change. It might not always be the same. It depends on what piece of the material that you want to keep. The reason being is that saw blade's almost an eighth of an inch thick, and an eighth of an inch is almost a mile when it comes to tolerances. Now, when it goes to miter cuts, check out the video we did a while back on miter cuts, because I think it's a pretty good one. The important thing is we don't take any material out of it when we go to cut that miter joint. If you're cutting them after you cut your original links, which is what I did for this project, you just want to make sure you're just really nipping the end of it, not trying to get the actual corner too much. You can lay this out, make a mark. I like to do my good old eyeball trick and just line the back of the blade up with the corner of the material on the back, and I usually get it right. But if you're cutting multiple different miters at different angles, make sure you change your saw blade up at the right time. I got in too much of a groove on this project. I was cutting 45s like crazy, and I realized I cut probably 6 or 7 pieces at 45s when they should have been cut at 22.5. I can't get that metal back, Jack. So we had to make sure that we had that little bit of extra material left over, because that stuff happens. And I went ahead and cut the right angles so that we could get the right angles. That's a fabrication joke. Now, I would say most of the time this goes without saying it, but using the tool the right way is super important. There are a slew of fabrication tools that you're going to be using, especially if you're building certain projects. We're just going to talk general tools, going back to squares, levels, tape measure, those basic tools there I've seen people use so stupidly wrong. Pulling measurements on the wrong side of parts. I've seen people pull measurements and like look at it for split second, be like, got it. And it's like, no, you don't. Pay attention and focus. Same thing with levels. Teaching pipe fitting classes and being a welder, watching pipe fitters is where I've had most of my experience. And watching guys put a level on a piece of pipe like sideways like this. And sometimes it's laughable because it's not even working for them. I don't think it's obvious to people because they're such simple tools to use. You put it on there, look, find the bubble and get it straight. But make sure they're exact. Putting a square where there's a little tack or a little burr where it's keeping it from being square, or putting a square up against it just a little bit sideways and not laying it sitting it flat, especially with like a square like this, just a thin piece of sheet metal. And if you don't put that sucker in there square straight up and down, it doesn't give you the right reading, and you're gonna do something and tack something that's not square. Using your tools the right way, it's obviously important, but some of y'all, I don't think it's obvious enough. One of those tools that you really need to focus on as a welder fabricator is the welder itself, because you can't just start slapping and tacking stuff when it comes to fabricating. Layout is not necessarily something you have to do, it's optional, but I think it really helps to look at your plan, find the parts that you need, and lay out the marks and where the other parts intersect or where they go together, and see if something's gonna work or not work by the time you haven't even put a tack on it yet. Then we can start really double checking measurements and start tacking. I never just start tacking one piece solid. I like putting one tack on and working my way around a project to make sure it's still able to shift and move and get square before I can really start laying in some tacks. Obviously, fixturing like this is super helpful. Having something clamped down, because you can lay something out, go ahead and clamp it down, and you can kind of tack without much of a worry. If you remember that video we did a while back about why tacks are so important, distortion happens. With a bigger part, a little tack may not move something a whole lot. Something like a little piece of this 1-inch tube right here, it can really start to pull with just one little tack. So for this entire build, being that the basket was made out of a lot of 1-inch angle iron and 1-inch tubing, I wanted to tack here, go opposite and tack there. Even if I did do the one piece, we're still tacking opposite sides, making sure that it's back to where it needs to be after the tack. You might have to tack, pull, tack, pull. That third tack's gonna lock it in. Sometimes you have to cut a tack and remove it. That's just a part of the process. All those compounded issues from not paying attention to your cuts, to not using your tools properly, to not doing the layout, and it starts making a really sloppy project. That's not to mention even the welding. You can mess the whole thing right up if you just start welding things really hard and solid, especially like if you just had a tube sitting out here and it's free floating and you go about welding it, it has so much room to move. If you start boxing it in and locking it in with other pieces of metal and tacks, then it doesn't move as much. Or if, again, if you have it fixtured, I'm either gonna weld one direction all the way around if I can move or roll the part. And if I can't do that, then I'm gonna weld one side, then try to go to the other side and weld the other side. Do what most welders call quartering out the weld, if it is something around or square, has multiple sides to it. Spreading out that heat and distortion evenly so that I can mitigate that at all costs. Pipe fitters always would say, welder pulled it after the spool was welded or the piece was welded, and then they go to check it and it's out. It wasn't their fault, it's my fault. If there's a weld on it, it's not the fitter's fault anymore, it's the welder's fault. Putting a nice finish on something is honestly its own art form. You can take a turd that's not worth selling and probably make it worth selling by polishing it up, or you could take something that's worth selling and making it a whole lot more valuable because you put a whole lot nicer finish on it. Sure, you can leave the welds on there. You could leave the little bit of BBs and buckshot on the steel itself. This is just terrible craftsmanship. You should never do that as a welder fabricator. That should just grind your gears. This job is so important that some companies dedicate it to one individual to find those BBs and making sure everything is silky smooth. Maybe it's ready for some paint or powder. In this case, we're going to just spray paint the thing. So we're going to do the bare minimum here, and I'm just gonna go ahead and take this fiber disc and knock down all the welds. It just looks better, just having a nice, flat, smooth surface, maybe a little bit of nicer corners where people are gonna see it. It just looks better. Once you get things taken down, that's all good, but now you got some deep scratches that you're gonna see through some paint. So I take a Scotch-Brite surface conditioning rollout disc, and I'm just gonna go ahead and take those deeper scratches out. If you go the opposite direction of the scratches you did before, you'll be able to see when you've gotten those scratches out, so you don't waste any time. Once I've got all those welds ground down and they're nice and smooth, that metal is super gritty, it's super oily, it's super dirty. We're gonna have to clean it. I'm just taking acetone and a rag and wiping it down, but you can just see how nasty this metal really is. As you're running your hand up and down it, wiping it and cleaning it, you can feel those BBs or buckshot, and it's a good time to really make sure that there's no sharp edges and corners or BBs while you're rubbing your hands all over it cleaning the material. Then we can go about slapping this spray paint on it. I'm a terrible painter. I would rather take a whooping than paint anything. It's black, it's painted, it's for my pops for Christmas. If he wants some more paint on it, he could throw it on himself. Here it is, here's the finished product. That old dog will hunt. We'll see you on the next weld.